I'd like to bring up our introducer tonight, Laura Overdeck. Laura has been a friend of this museum and of me for many years, since before the museum existed, in fact. But she is better known at this point for being the founder of Bedtime Math. And for those of you who have young children or grandchildren or nieces or nephews or anybody in your world who you would like to instill a love of math in that person, you want to know about these books. And so I am delighted to welcome Laura Overdeck.
Thanks so much, Cindy. It is great to be here. Great to see a packed house for what is going to be the most awesome presentation. So to warm us up for that, I thought I'd start with talking about what's wrong with America, in case you got here and you didn't think anything was wrong. And what I specifically want to talk about is a specific fear, the fear of math. Now, you all love math, right? And even if you don't, you would never admit it in this room. And so you can keep that to yourself. But out there, lots of people really hate math. There are adults who are willing to say, I just can't do math, or I don't need math in my life. People are really nervous about it. They see an X and they just start sweating. And this is why restaurants now have to, on the receipt, print the suggested tip, because people are not comfortable dividing by 5 or 6 to figure out what that number is. And this is a sad state of affairs. So how did we get here? There are a lot of theories about that. My theory is that today's adults grew up as kids who were never engaged in math, who never found it fun. They may not have really done math in the home in a playful way, so their only experience was school. In school, they probably had boring worksheets that didn't seem to have a lot of meaning. And worst of all, they may not have understood it, because the way school has worked the last 100 years is that it moves along at a certain pace and all the kids in the class follow it. And if you hit a topic and you don't understand it, you don't have time to stop and dig into it and really understand it. The class is going to keep moving, so you have to memorize what you need to do. And what happens is you start having a pile of things that you've memorized that you sometimes carry the one and you're not sure why. Or when you add fractions, the bottoms have to match, but that isn't true when you multiply. Why not? There are reasons for these things, but if you have to keep memorizing and remembering all this stuff, it eventually turns into panic, and that's how you get the state of affairs today with adults, parents, as well as teachers often. I run into this all the time as the founder of Bedtime Math. Our mission is to help kids love math at a young age so that they grow up to love it as adults. We all know to read a bedtime story. That's a cherished tradition. It's warm and fuzzy. People read for pleasure. We don't have a lot of math for pleasure, right? How often do you hear people say that? So bedtime math is all about giving kids fun math at night. And what's interesting is we don't have a problem convincing the kids. The kids love it if they get a chance to try it. They love learning the math behind cool patterns or some weird animal with cool facts about it or food. In fact, right in this room, I led a big group discussion with kids about the 10-second rule. How long can food sit on the floor before you're going to die if you eat it? Kids had, this is a quantification problem, right? Kids had all kinds of ideas. 2 seconds, 10 seconds, 12 seconds. One kid in the back yelled, infinity. And then I looked and it was my kid because we just eat off the floor in our house. But like the thing is, the kids get into it. You know, they love it. It's the parents. It's the parents we're trying to convince. That's what's so difficult. And this is where we bring in Eugenia Cheng, because she is a multifaceted, multidimensional person who is bringing it all together in such a fun way. She is a mathematician who lectures not only at the University of Sheffield, but also at the School of the Art Institute in Chicago. That is a very interesting dual office to have. She is also an accomplished pianist and a passionate and talented cook. And what she is doing is tying in math with topics that people already love, like music and food. Her book, How to Bake Pie, is such an awesome bait and switch, because every chapter begins with a recipe, but then goes on to show how the thinking in that recipe ties in with mathematical principles. You will see this tonight, she makes a Battenberg cake where the squares, when you cut the cake and see the cross section, the squares are different flavors that cannot touch the same flavor. But then it turns out there are all kinds of mathematical exercises that reflect the same pattern. In another chapter, she made a conference chocolate cake where she had surprise guests and had to whip together a chocolate cake with whatever was in the house. Thankfully, chocolate she had available. And her point there is, you can't just memorize things. She had to be nimble on the fly in an unknown situation. Math is the same way. You can't memorize it. You have to feel it and understand the principles. Because when you are truly fluent in it, you are confident. And confidence brings playfulness. And when you then bring math and food together, playfulness brings yumminess. And that is exactly what tonight's talk is about. So with that, I welcome Dr. Cheng.
Thank you so much, Laura. And first of all, I would like to thank Cindy and MoMath for inviting me here to talk to you today. And it's so great to see a full house of people who want to come and hear about math in the evening. Now, first, I would just like to say, are there any small children who are at the back and can't see enough? Is there any way we can bring, if you'd like to come and sit on the floor at the front, then you're welcome to, because I'd love you to be able to see small children. Oh, look. Hi. You can sit over here as well. Hi. Wonderful. So I'm going to talk about math and food. And I love math and I love food. And unfortunately, most people love food more than they love math. Oh, you do. See, some people love math more than food. And I like to bring my love of food into math so that I can make a connection with everyone about math. And I think that, as Laura said, there are many things a little bit amiss with the way math is sometimes taught in school. And I know there are probably some wonderful math teachers here in the audience, because if you're a math teacher and you're here, it's probably because you're fantastic. But unfortunately, there are many other math classes, and I know this because I teach art students now, and my art students are almost all people who were turned off math in school. And I talk to them, it's a bit like therapy, about their past math trauma. And I talk to them about what it was that put them off math. And over the course of my class, in one semester, I turn them all around so that they love math and that they think math is relevant to them. Because it's not just about numbers, and it's not just about equations and formulae. And it's not about memorizing multiplication tables. And it's not really about memorizing anything. And it's interesting, because my art students tell me they got put off math because they had to memorize things. Whereas I loved math because I didn't have to memorize anything. I hate memorizing things except music. But because I felt that if I understood it, that was all I needed. And if you do understand it, that is all you need. And so the math that I do with art students is the kind of math I think I can do with everybody. We build things, we create things, we explore, just like you can in the kitchen. And for me, the most fun part of math started when I got to do research and I got to make my own things up. Because then you just invent a world. You invent a mathematical world and then you explore it. Just like when you don't have to follow someone else's recipe when you're cooking anymore, it becomes more fun, I think. You get to invent your own recipe, and then nobody has to tell you whether it's right or wrong. You just decide whether you think it's delicious. I mean, you might poison yourself, but apart from that, it's just about whether you like it or not. And in the end, math is like that too. So I'm going to show you some of my favorite mathematical structures that you might not have thought of as being mathematical. Because math really is everywhere, whether you see it or not. And I think it's more fun when you do see it. So here are the things I'm going to talk about. I'm going to talk about Bach, juggling, hair, factors of 30, that is kind of mathematical, cake, and custard. And so what is math? I have to tell you, first of all, what I think math is. Math is the study of how things work. But it's not just any old study of how things work, and it's not just the study of how any old things work. It's the study of how logical things work. And not just any old study of how logical things work, it's the logical study of how logical things work. And the trouble with that is that nothing works logically. I don't work logically, you don't work logically, sorry, but you probably don't. But the computer definitely doesn't work logically. Nothing actually works logically. And so in order to study anything logically, we have to ignore the pesky details that prevent things that work logically, and that takes us into the world of ideas. So we move from the real world into the abstract world of ideas where things really work logically. And that world, that move can seem scary because you don't really have your feet on the ground anymore. You're just working in the world of ideas. But if you like ideas and you like logic, it's a beautiful place to be. If you like winning arguments by yelling, then you won't like that world because you can't win arguments by yelling. Unfortunately, there are quite a lot of people who do like winning arguments by yelling. But in this world, you can only win arguments by making logical arguments. And it's not even really about winning and losing. It's not about right and wrong. It's about exploring, understanding, and thinking more clearly. And wouldn't it be better, particularly in these days, wouldn't it be better if more people were able to think more clearly? So first, I'm going to talk about one of my favorite pieces of music, which is a piece by Bach. Bach wrote many pieces of music, and there was a lot of math in what he wrote, so much that I could probably talk about that by itself for about 3 weeks, so I won't do that. But he wrote preludes and fugues in every key, because a mathematical advance at the time meant that it became possible to tune instruments in every key. Previously, you could only tune them in some keys, and the other ones would all sound terrible. But it was so exciting that you could actually play music in every key that Bach wrote a piece in every key. And there are 12 keys on the piano, so he wrote 12, but he wrote major and minor, so that makes 24. And then he got really excited and did it all again, so that makes 48. So he actually wrote 48 preludes and fugues. And this one is from the second book in G minor. It's one of my favorites. If there were a piano, I would play it, but instead, I have a video of me playing it. This is my very tidy piano studio in Chicago. And here is me, slightly unkempt, playing this piece. Hopefully we have sound.
Thank you.
like many pieces of Bach, this is written in polyphony, which means that there are different voices of music that exist kind of independently, and they wind their way around each other. And you could, in theory, get some people to sing it. So the first line of music is the one that the top line starts here, and it goes, ba-da-da-da, do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. And then the second line is this one that goes, ba-da-da-da. And when I first studied this piece of music, I got very confused. I felt that I couldn't follow where the different lines of music were, and so I decided to draw a picture of it. And the picture came out like this. So this picture is a very extreme abstraction of the piece of music, in which I've forgotten every detail apart from where each line of music is in relation to the others at any given moment. And so this is the top line. This black one is the top line, but you can see that it comes down. So it starts as a soprano and ends up as a tenor. And this one starts as the alto and ends up as the bass. And the bass line winds its way up and ends up as the alto. And so now you can see that if you did get four people to try and sing it, it would be a bit difficult, because most people can't sing all those different parts. I have one friend who can sing soprano, alto, tenor, and bass, but that's only one. And I also began to understand why I didn't understand. And when you understand why you don't understand, that's the first step to understanding something. And I realized it was because the lines of music cross over and don't come back. Usually in polyphony, they cross very briefly and come back again. But because they kind of creep up the back, I lost them. Once I drew this picture, I could understand the structure, the abstract structure, better, and then I felt I could play the piece better. And this is the thing, that you don't have to see this picture in order to listen to the piece and enjoy the piece. But I feel I can play it better because I understand this picture. And it's the same with math. You don't have to understand the math of your cell phone to use your cell phone. And you don't have to understand the math of cars to drive a car. You don't have to understand where the structural walls are in this building in order to use this building. It's a good thing someone knows where they are. And the math is everywhere, whether you know it or not. People sometimes say to me, you know what? I get on fine without math. And I say, yeah, but I get on better. So if you understand how things work, you can use them better. But best of all, you can invent your own things. You can make things better. You can improve them. You can break them when they're fit. Well, you can break them. You can break them. You can also fix them when you've broken them. And so this, to me, is what math is about. And this abstraction means that lots of different things become the same that were previously not the same. So, for example, if you say, if I have one apple and another apple, that makes two apples. And if I have one banana and another banana, that makes two bananas. And if I have one monkey and another monkey, that makes two monkeys. And you go, oh, something's going on here. If I have one thing and another thing, that makes two things. So I might as well just call that 1 add 1 equals 2. And that right there is an abstraction from things to numbers. Numbers are already an abstraction that you've all got used to, and you've forgotten doing it. If you help small children, maybe you have some younger brothers and sisters, if you help them learn how to count, they're confused at first, and making that leap from objects to numbers is a big leap. And the next leap that usually happens is from numbers to letters, and people often say to me, I was all right with math until all those numbers became X's and Y's. And then sometimes people get on fine with the X's and Y's, but then they get stuck when it's calculus. And sometimes people hit their ceiling of abstraction in the middle of their PhD, and that's really tricky. So people hit that ceiling at all sorts of different, I haven't hit mine yet. I don't know if I have one. But anyway, one of the reasons I love abstraction is because it makes lots of things the same, so you can study them all at the same time. And that's good, because I'm very lazy. And math actually comes from mathematicians being so lazy that they don't want to do the same thing over and over again, so they always make a theory that does it for them. And math is there to make our lives easier, actually. You might think it's there to torture you in school, but it's actually there to make our lives easier. So I'm going to show you some things that become the same when we abstract from them. Now, these things are called braids in mathematics. And actually, I drew this picture when I was still an undergraduate. And then when I started my PhD, these braids appeared in the research that I was reading, and I didn't know that was going to happen. And they're also related to juggling. I used to say, I can't juggle. And then someone said to me, you know, that's like when people say, I can't do math. So I stopped saying, I can't juggle. Instead, I said, I'm practicing. I'm getting better at it. I'm still not really good enough to do it in front of an audience. So I wonder if someone would like to do a juggling demonstration for me. Is there someone who can juggle? Hooray! Give a round, big round of applause. What's your name?
Ariel.
Ariel, wonderful. Here are some non-juggling balls, but they're fruit. They're delicious fruit. If you drop the apple, it will smush. He's not going to drop anything. That's it. This is just going to be a juggling show now. Now, would you please walk across the stage and keep doing just the normal juggling pattern? And see, can you imagine if we had a long exposure camera, what would happen if we took a long exposure picture so that the fruit makes paths through the air? Could you just walk across? Can you see the pattern?
Yes, they would wrap around in a coil.
Would they be in a coil? Here is an actual long exposure picture I made. Thank you very much. Big round of applause. That was wonderful. Thank you. So I made this picture with illuminated juggling balls. I made this picture at a school in Chicago, and when I tried juggling, it was so wonky that it didn't make a very good picture. So we found a third grader who did this juggling for me. Here's one I made on the computer. And so if you can see that what we have here is a red apple, we have a green orange, and a blue lemon. So the green apple goes across like this, and at the same time, the blue lemon crosses over this way. And while the blue lemon is going, the red apple goes that way, and it makes this picture like this. And it is really a braid. And if I turn it this way up, then you can see it's the same as the braid in my hair. And this is another kind of braid that we study in mathematics. I once tried to braid my hair in the Bach braid. You can see that doesn't work at all. Because you would have to have a band here, a band here, a band here. It just doesn't stay in place at all. Whereas we all know, everyone who's ever braided hair knows, that when you do a normal braid, you only need one band at the end. And if I take this band out and then I pretend I'm in a shampoo commercial, which I always wanted to be in a shampoo commercial when I was little. There were several things. I wanted to be in a shampoo commercial and on a cooking show. Anyway, I actually always wanted to be a mathematician, but that's a whole nother story. So this braid, mathematicians study how tangled up braids are. And we study this mathematically. It's a part of a field called topology, which is about shape. And the fact that this one is tangled up enough to stay in place has a mathematical explanation, whereas this one, the green band is floating around and the black strand is floating around. Whereas if you look at just the red and the blue ones, they're interlocking with each other, so they won't move. Now, this is something that mathematicians study because it's interesting. And a lot of the things we do, we just study because they're interesting, not because we see a particular use for it. However, this turns out to be useful because potentially it might be related to early diagnosis of Alzheimer's disease because they think it might be something to do with the way brain cells get tangled. And if they're mutated and tangled the wrong way, we need to be able to detect when the tangle has changed mathematically. So it could be useful, but that's not the first reason we studied it. And math often happens like that. Sometimes it takes 2,000 years or 3,000 years for a piece of math to become actually useful. And so often the use is more just in how it helps us to think. And it's just like, I think math has this unfortunate burden of being, there's a demand on it that it should be directly useful. And I think this is like trying to get a young person to be interested in something by saying it's useful, I think is a bit futile. It's like introducing someone and saying, I'd like you to meet my friend. They're very useful. So I think that interesting is a better thing to say about math and friends. I couldn't make this braid in my hair, so I made it into a pie instead. This is my Bach pie. It is banana and chocolate, so it's a Bach pie. And we're now going to think about some factors of 30, and we have some activities that are going to come round for the factors of 30. But first of all, let's just think about what the factors of 30 are. Can we remember? Yeah, what? Start at the lowest. What's the small? One, two. Five,
six,
ten, 15, and 30. Very good. That's not very interesting. It's a bunch of numbers in a straight line. It's kind of interesting, but it could be more interesting. See, we live in a three-dimensional world. So unfortunately, we write on two-dimensional pieces of paper in one-dimensional straight lines. And so we squash everything into one-dimensional straight lines when really they have natural geometry that we've squashed. And this, I say, is why I don't like to tidy up the papers on my desk, because they have natural geometry where they are. So let's discover the natural geometry of this situation, where we're going to see which numbers are factors of each other. And then we can draw a kind of family tree, because family trees are there to show relationships between things. So 30 is kind of the great grandparent here. And then we have 6, 10, and 15 that go into 30. 5 goes into 10 and 15. 2 goes into 6 and 10. 3 goes into 6 and 15. And 1 goes into 2, 3, and 5. So now we see that it's the corners of a cube, which I think is much more interesting than numbers in a straight line. And it's a cube a different way up from the way we usually see it, because usually we think of cubes like this on a face. But this is a cube on its corner. And so the 6, the 10, and the 15 are the three corners at the top. And if I rotate the cube by its corners, you can see those three corners rotating between each other. And it's related to the little brain teaser that says, if I suspend a cube by one corner and drop it halfway in water, what shape does the cube make on the surface of the water?
Hexagon.
And they're very good. You were right the first time. The answer is a hexagon. And so these little card things we've handed out, which the museum has beautifully laser cut, are for us all to make models of a cube cut in half along the hexagon face. Yeah, do you have a question? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we're going to make them now. So everybody should have these templates. The idea here is that if you can see, there's some little lines which are laser cut lines for you to fold along. So if you just fold along each of those lines, fold them all in the same direction, then you should find that the numbers match up. So all the ones will match up. And just fold them so that they make right angles. And then it should turn into this thing. And you can tape it together. And then you'll see the hexagon face that appears. So we need, is there a yellow? Are there any more yellow ones? Okay. Well, we'll have pink. If we could just have a few. Yeah, yeah. And now you can build different things. You can turn them backwards as well and turn them into other things.
If you get 1.00000, because it all cancels.
When it's done, the first thing you can do is you can hold it together to make a cube that divides into two equal halves in the non-obvious way. But then you can also join up with your friends. And if you turn them backwards, you can build all sorts of different things with them. So if I put two together backwards, then they make this. And then if you can get eight, then you put them to, if you put eight together, then they make something which is actually a truncated octahedron, which is quite fun. You can also do this. And if you put eight together this way, then it makes a cube with something cut out of the inside. So these things make lots of different things. But if you just put them together in the ordinary cube, then if you position it correctly, then you can see which numbers are factors of each other. And then you see that one and the prime factors are in one half, and the non-prime factors are on the other half. And I think that's a much more interesting structure of numbers than just a bunch of numbers in a straight line. You can connect them anyhow you want. And you can take them home and you can keep doing it at home. So the other thing that we can do with a cube relates it back to the braids that we had. I can wrap up this cube with ribbon as if it were a present. And so here I'm going to use red and blue ribbons. And then those red and blue ribbons are going to carry on down the sides of the cube. And now I need a third color. It's going to come across here. So that makes a green going across like that. And if I wrap up the other present with the same colors starting in the same places, so the red will start here and the blue here and the green here, then it looks like this. And now maybe you can see that if you shuffle the red and the green crossing down a little bit and the green ribbon up, this turns into that. So mathematically, those are the same braid. And this is something that has a fancy name in math. It's called the third Rademeister move. We like to give things fancy names in math because it makes us feel clever. But actually, it's just to help us remember what things are. And lots of some mathematicians, unfortunately, like talking in the strange words specifically so that people won't understand because it makes them feel clever. I don't believe in that. I believe in bringing everybody in. This is something else that I saw during my PhD, and I realized that I could try it on my Bach braid. So this is the one where you start with a cube, and you put the ribbon on it, you wrap it up. And I thought, well, how about I start with the Bach braid, and I make a present, and I reverse engineer the present to be the right shape to fit under that braid. And I thought about it, and I discovered that it's a cube. And when I realized it was also a cube, I did exactly what I do whenever I discover something, prove a mathematical theorem. I go, oh my goodness, that's fantastic. And then 2 seconds later, I go, oh, I'm probably wrong. And then 2 seconds later, I go, maybe it's trivial. And then 2 seconds later, I think, I bet everyone in the world knows this apart from me. That is honestly the process that I go through every time I prove a theorem. So like a good mathematician, I checked it. I thought, I wonder if every braid makes a cube. And I realized, no, it needs 6 faces to be a cube. So it needs 6 crossings. So I thought, maybe every 6 crossing braid is a cube. But then I realized that's not true either, because you could just have 2 strands and go cross, 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 and that wouldn't be a cube. So I don't know why this is a cube. I phoned a friend, my friend who actually sings soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and I said, oh my goodness, and he said, I think it shows that Bach was communing with the spirit of the Platonic solids. And I don't think that's what was going on. I don't know why this is happening, and I don't know if it's useful. But I think it's cool, and I think that's enough. That's enough for me anyway, and there's a lot of math I just think is really cool, and that's why I'm showing it to you. The next thing that I think is cool is cake, Battenberg cake especially. It's one of my favorite kinds of cake. Of all cooking, I most like making desserts because they are nutritionally valueless. Anything that has actual nutritional value, I'd rather leave to someone else. This is only there to make me happy. And isn't that nice? Battenberg cake is a very English kind of cake. It's supposedly related to the crest of the Battenbergs or something. But the main point is that you have 2 colors of cake, and you definitely don't want the same color to touch itself, because that would be terrible. So this is how it looks, and it's actually the same as a mathematical structure. We can do multiplication of 1 and negative 1. And here we're going to put 1 times 1, which is 1. Usually. And here we're going to put 1 times negative 1, which is negative 1. And here we're going to put negative 1 times negative 1, which is 1. So it's a Battenberg cake. And we can try this again by adding even and odd numbers. Here we're going to put even number plus an even number. Even. And here, if you add an even number and an odd number, you get odd. And if you add an odd number and an odd number, you get even. So it's a Battenberg cake. And we can now try this with multiplication of real and imaginary numbers. Now, you might not know, you might not remember what real and imaginary numbers are, but imaginary numbers are that thing that happens when they tell you at school you can't take the square root of a negative number, and then the next year they tell you, oh, now we're going to take the square root of a negative number. So imaginary numbers are what happens when you take the square root of a negative number. Now, it doesn't matter if you know what they are, I'm going to tell you that they make a Battenberg cake. So a real number times a real number must be real. And a real number times an imaginary number must be imaginary. And an imaginary number times an imaginary number must be real, because I told you it's a Battenberg cake. And now we can extend this and we can talk about bed flipping. Mattress flipping is what you're supposed to do every season to stop your fat bottom from digging into the same part of the mattress. all year. I never do it because I'm much too lazy. But if I were going to do it, I would definitely write letters on my mattress, and this is why I've given you something with A, B, C, D on it, to remember where I am. Now, this is the trouble with supposedly real-life math problems. Usually they're nothing to do with real life at all. Like, they say things like, you have 87 wild horses and 15 of them escape, because yes, I definitely have 87 wild horses. And my friends often send me the homework questions that their children have been given when they're really ridiculous. And my favorite one to date has been, you have 1 meter of string. You use 30 centimeters of it to tie up Tommy. You use 35% of it to tie up Adam. How much do you have left to tie up Sam? And apart from the question of why we're tying people up, 30 centimeters is not very long to tie a piece of string to tie someone up with. So anyway, what we can do is we can make a little table of what happens to our mattress. And here is where you do nothing and then you do nothing again because you're me and you're too lazy to flip your mattress. So you always stay, if you start in the A position, you always stay in the A position. Here is where you do nothing and then you rotate. So this is what I'm calling rotate. And that gets us into the B position. So if we start in the A position and we rotate, we get to B, rotate. And then here, we're going to start in the A position and then we're going to flip over sideways. And that takes us to C. And if we start in the A position and flop over, that's what I'm calling flop, that takes us to the D position. Now, going down here, we're going to do the same move and then nothing afterwards. And that gives the same answer because if we do nothing, it doesn't matter when we do nothing. I do it all the time, frankly. But this gives us the same answer. So let's try doing a rotate and then a rotate. So if we start in the A position, we rotate, and then we rotate again, it gets us back to A. And here we can try flipping and flipping again. So we start in the A position, we flip over sideways, and then we flip over sideways again. And we get back into the A position. And here we can try flopping, so we flop over, and then we flop over again, and this gets us to the A position again. So that tells us if we do the same move every season, we're always going to miss things out because we keep coming back to A. So we can now try mixing them up. We can try doing a rotation and then a flip. So we rotate and then flip over sideways. That takes us to the D position. And here we can try rotating and then flop. So start back in the A position. So we rotate and then flop. That takes us to the C position. And here we're going to flip and then rotate. So start in the A position. We flip over sideways, and then we rotate, D. And here we're going to flip and then flop. And this is the whole point. I get to say flip, flop. B, very good. Now maybe you can guess what's going to be here.
Oh, wait, C.
C, very good. And what do you think? Guess what's going to be there. B. Very good. And now because we're good mathematicians, not people on the internet, we could check that it's really true. So we can check this flop and then rotate, so we can flop and rotate and see that we really do get that. And we can check the other one as well. Math is often about spotting patterns and guessing. It's not all about knowing, it's about guessing the right answer and then checking using logic. Now, the real question here is, how many Battenberg cakes can we see? So how many Battenberg cakes can you see in that picture? There's these ones. There's one in the middle. And there's the big one, where it's a cake, Battenberg cake, each of whose cakes was already a Battenberg cake. Here's one I made.
Oh, that's a chest.
Uh-huh. And here's where I put the letters on to show you what it is. I call this the iterated Battenberg cake, because I have iterated the process of Battenbergification. And Battenbergification is basically like painting by numbers. So if I tell you that we are Battenbergifying, all I have to do is tell you what goes in position one and what goes in position two, and you can make the picture. So it can be yellow and pink. It could be chocolate and more chocolate, because that's always good. It could be a bunny and another kind of bunny. Or it could be one kind of Battenberg cake and another kind of Battenberg cake. And that's why it's the iterated Battenberg cake. If you try to make this cake, you have to cut off so much cake to make the squares perfect that you end up with more leftover cake than cake, which is good for your friends. I can make an even more abstract representation of this, because all I have to do is tell you what goes in position one and two. So I might as well just draw it like that. So it could be yellow and pink, it could be light brown and dark brown, it could be bunny one and bunny two, it could be cake one and cake two. Now what is cake one? Cake one is one of those. And what is cake two? Cake two is one of these. Now I might as well put the whole picture for cake one in this the one spot. And I might as well put the whole picture for cake two in the two spot. And now I've made an extremely abstract representation of the Battenberg cake, where what I've told you is how these four ingredients get put together to make the final result. And this is what mathematicians study, and they're called trees, because they look a bit like trees. And they show us how we stick things together. Now, here are two trees showing how to stick three things together in two different ways. This one says put the first two things together and then the third one afterwards. This one says put the second two things together and the first one afterwards. And we can ask if we get the same answer. So we can try this with adding numbers together. If we add four and four, we get eight. And if we add two on afterwards, we get 10. And we usually, because we squash things into straight lines, we usually represent this using parentheses, because we have to put in a straight line instead of the tree. The other way around says add four and two first, which makes six. And then if we add four afterwards, it makes 10. And this way round, the parentheses go over here. And you might remember this as the associative law for addition. But really, it's about moving branches of trees around. And if we didn't have to squash everything into a straight line, it would have been represented by these tree pictures instead. Now, the thing is that numbers behave like this. But when we study more subtle things than numbers, they don't necessarily behave like this. For example, if we add egg yolks and sugar, and then we add milk and heat it up, we get custard. The other way around says mix the sugar and the milk first, and then mix the egg yolks, and we do not get custard. So these two things are not the same. However, if you're making cake, it doesn't really matter so much. But the cake recipe I've always used says first mix the sugar and the butter, then mix the eggs in, and finally fold in the flour, and that makes cake. But actually, it turns out, especially if you have an electric mixer, basically you can just chuck everything in a bowl and go, and so it's fine. And that's what that tree looks like. Now, if you actually try all the possibilities, and I brought all the cake ingredients into my art class, and we mixed cake in lots of different ways. And here are all the different ways you can mix cake. So each of these arrows represents moving one branch across, just like this. So here I've moved the butter branch across. So this new recipe says mix the butter and the eggs, which, by the way, looks really disgusting. And then mix the sugar, and finally mix the flour afterwards. But actually, it turns out that if you beat it hard enough, it kind of turns out all right. Now, this one at the bottom is interesting, because it says mix the sugar and the butter, but also mix the eggs and the flour, so you need two bowls. And if you're me and you're lazy, you don't want to wash an extra bowl. So that really makes a difference. Now, this one over here says do the whole thing backwards, mix the eggs and the flour, which is a very odd thing to do, and then the butter, and then the sugar. But again, if you beat hard enough, it turns out all right. However, we do not have ovens at art school, unfortunately, so we couldn't actually bake it to see what would happen. We just looked at it and said, it looks kind of the same. However, I went to speak at the Culinary Institute of America recently, and they do have ovens. And so we baked it to see what would really happen. And what happened was it was all like cake. It's just that some of it rose more than others. So the normal method was definitely the easiest, and it rose a lot. But actually, I think it was this one and this one that both rose quite well, whereas the top right one and the bottom one were really flat. And so in the end, they still looked like cake, and they still tasted like cake. And actually, I quite like dense cake. So it depends what you like about your cake. It also depends whether you're the person making it or not. It depends if you care that halfway through your cake process, your batter looks like vomit. And when you're doing higher level math, you get to decide a lot more about what counts as the same or not. When you're just doing numbers, things are just equal or not. When you're studying more subtle objects, there are lots of different ways in which things can be the same. Just like if you offer a child two pieces of chocolate cake, they might really care which one they get because one of them will definitely be better than the other. Whereas as adults, we sort of get used to the fact that it's okay that most of the pieces of chocolate cake are more or less the same. So there's a lot more decisions and opinions you get to have in math. And if you make a different decision, you just go into a different world. It's like a choose your own adventure thing. Probably don't have those anymore in the world of modern technology, but I'm showing my age. I used to have choose your own adventure books where you choose what you want to happen next. And there's something fun about making those choices. And math is really about making those choices. Unfortunately, too often when we teach it at school, we don't let anyone make any choices. And I think if we let everyone make some more choices, then you have more ownership over what you're doing. So I want to finally end by saying that category theory is what my field of research is. And there's actually been quite a lot of category theory. This is something that comes up only if you're doing a PhD in category theory, really. So are you a category theorist? Oh, hi. So this is actually something that's very important in my research. It's called the McLean Pentagon. It's about cake, really. And if you want to make chocolate cake, that also comes up because I do higher dimensional research. If you want to make chocolate cake, you're going to have one more ingredient. So all your trees will have one more leaf. And then the shape that you get if you draw all those is one has one more dimension. And here it is. Someone 3D printed it for me. And there's a picture in the book of a thing you can cut out and fold up to make it. So here it is. It has six pentagons and three squares. And we build this in my classes with the art students. Although they're art students, many of them can't multiply. They definitely can't divide. And yet they're doing this thing that I only did when I got to my PhD, which is in category theory, which is the mathematics of mathematics, I say. And if mathematics is the logical study of how logical things work, and category theory is the mathematics of mathematics, then if we unravel that, category theory is the logical study of the logical study of how logical things work. And I believe that this is all things that we can show everybody without you having to pass endless tests and memorize endless formulae, because it's really about creating worlds and making things delicious. So thank you very much for coming.
All right, so we have some time for questions in any categories. It doesn't matter. So if you could raise your hand, I will bring a microphone to you.
What was the change in instrument design which allowed the notes, individual notes, to be tuned independently as opposed to dependently?
Oh, it wasn't exactly that they were being tuned independently. It was that they used to tune using harmonics. And if you tune using harmonics, then all the strings have ratios that are rational numbers, so they're two-thirds and a half, so that the harmonics match up with each other. And in order to tune all the notes evenly, so when you do that, C and G are very beautiful, for example, and F, but then F sharp sounds terrible. And so to do it evenly, you have to make the square root of 12, so that the half step has to be a ratio of the square root of 12, because, wait, I didn't mean that, the 12th root of 2, because when you multiply it 12 times, you get to an octave. And that's a difficult thing to figure out if you don't have some advanced mathematics. So actually, there's some story, allegedly, someone in China figured this out on a huge abacus, a kind of 150-column abacus hundreds of years ago. I'm not sure if that's actually true. I once read it on the internet. So, so it's probably false. But then they figured out how to make it, once all the intervals are even, by the 12th root of 2, then they're all sort of equally out of tune. None of them is actually, the octaves are all in tune, but the fifths are slightly off. And so everything is slightly off instead of a few things being very off. It's kind of like the bump in the carpet. If you have a bump in the carpet, you can push it over there or you can spread it out evenly everywhere. And so now we spread it out evenly everywhere, so everything sounds more or less okay. That's what happened. Are there any more questions?
Yes. When you encountered Gödel's incompleteness theorem, mm-hmm. did it cause you any consternation?
Gödel's incompleteness theorem says that any logical system is either feeble or it necessarily has questions that can't be answered. And the reason is because if you're powerful enough to express self-reference, then you can use self-reference to create weird situations, like this sentence is false, or the next sentence is true, the previous sentence is false. And then you can get yourself into weird loops. I love those loops. It causes me no consternation whatsoever. I don't believe that mathematics is there to answer all questions. I believe that mathematics is there to help us understand what is at the logical core of the world. I have this image that there's logical stuff that's in the middle of everything, and there's illogical stuff that's everywhere else. And I don't think that's bad, because there are some things that we can't use logic to understand, either because logic is too slow, or because we simply don't have enough information, or because there are just too many variables, or because it involves things like human emotions, which do not behave according to logic, and that's wonderful. And without those non-logical things, there wouldn't be the beauty of music and poetry and love. And to me, the most exciting part is where the interface is, just between the things that we can explain by logic and the things we can't. So in music, I love trying to understand what is making me so excited about the music. And I'll analyze it and find everything I can. And just beyond all the things I can explain, there'll be one last thing which I can't explain. And to me, that's where the beauty is, just on the boundary. And I have this image that logic is the sphere at the center of everything that we understand, and that we should try and put as many things as possible in that sphere. And as we do, the sphere of logic grows, so the surface grows. And that surface is where beauty is, the interface between logic and illogic. So the more we understand with logic, the more access we have to the things that are beautiful.
It's like a rising cake.
Yes.
All right, so unless someone is desperate for a question, I think that it's well past some folks' bedtimes here. Fine, let's give Eugenia another round of applause. Thank you so much.